years ago, the Romans put a marker after they took 1,000 steps and called it a mile after their word for 1,000. And they put 1,000 step or mile markers on the roads they built. Now, if they'd have been a little shorter or walked with baby steps, we'd all be getting more miles to the gallon today. Welcome to Breakfast Time with Tom Berger and Lori Hibbert and Bob the Puppet. My name's Jim and I'm the announcer. Say good morning, Tom.
Good morning and aloha, Tom. Welcome to Breakfast Time. Very special segment today. Later on the show, Mark Furman and Bob Packwood talk about what's best, diaries or tape recorders. So we're looking forward. The dog loved that line. Let's get Lori Hibbert in here because it's not only a Friday, it's aloha Friday.
Yeah. That was like the lamest applause, you guys.
Let's do it again. Wait. Wait, Timmy's in the ravine. The first impressions are important.
Oh yeah.
Now we have someone from Harper's Bazaar magazine here. We have Carrie Doyle here, and for that tech. That's right. You read it too. Oh, you don't. You don't read it. You do. Yeah. Okay. Does he come with a silencer by any chance? Yeah. All right. Let's hear it for Lori Hibbert. Take
yeah.
two.
Yeah.
You're getting audio from the Cal Ripken Jr. tribute.
Like you think they're gonna win something if they keep playing.
Yeah. Cal Ripken didn't get an ovation like that the other day. All right, every Friday, for those of you new to the show this week, since we've moved our time in most time zones, every Friday we celebrate the approaching weekend by doing a little ditty called the Friday Strut. We invite you to get up and do that with us. We're going to be dedicating it to Aurora Pedrolini from Plainville, Connecticut, who in turn dedicates it to all the teachers and students going back to school.
Oh, good for her. Right. We also ask everybody around the country to strut with us, including our remotes, Jillian Hamilton in Austin, Texas this morning. Jill, y'all set to strut?
We are ready to strut. Whoa. We're in Austin with the Ballet Folklorico, Mariachi, the mayor,
wonderful.
The councilman. Woo. Everything is wonderful. We are ready to strut.
Bueno, okay. Bueno.
Bill's in Moore Park, California at the Worm Connection. Are those worms ready to strut?
Oh, yeah, we're ready to strut. All four of us.
That's
worms,
right.
A thousand right. worms. We're ready to go.
And is our Hawaiian luau party in Madison Square Park all set?
Oh, they look ready.
Okay.
That looks wonderful. We're going to have a luau today.
Well, let's bring everybody in. Karen, Bryant, and Sheena, and JD, Patricia, all of our guests, our visiting viewers, our little pups who are here for a doggy fashion segment. Carrie from Harper's Bazaar, come on. All right, now, all you got to do, it's a highly improvisational dance number.
Yeah,
and we're
interpretive dance, you might say.
All right, you ready at home? Okay. Come on, Tepper. Come on. Just because you're working on another show, now you come in here. All right, Rob, we are ready. Hit it. On the show today.
Come on, Rob.
See what happens when you're defenseless, they dress you up.
You look like you got mugged by the Golden Girls.
That's right, Bob.
We've got actress Lori Loughlin joining us live on remote from Los Angeles, California.
And John Pryor's here in the apartment, too. It's reggae strut. I'm going to change. You leave the strut.
Okay.
Now, every Friday in Hawaii, Hawaii is Aloha Friday. It's not like a once a year, twice a year thing. They do it like we do the Friday strut, like we say TGIF, that type of thing. So we are going to be celebrating that as well.
That'll today. Be very exciting. And we're also going to have Jane Wallace here from Under Scrutiny. We're very happy to welcome her today. Yes. Jane Wallace, newswoman, is going to talk about the presidential candidates, the frontrunners anyway.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Jane Wallace Orchestra. Yeah, you know what we're going to do? We're going to talk about campaign curveballs. How?
Oh, I thought it was about the...
Yeah, well, we want to respond to the fact that Bob Packwood leaving may get Phil Graham into the Finance Committee, which Bob Dole doesn't want to have happen. It could mess with his presidential aspirations. Also, Colin Powell's wife said she doesn't want him to run. And he's considering an independent bid, possibly.
He's out.
And, yeah, and also, do you remember, and that echoes Newt Gingrich's wife saying, if he announces for the presidency the next day, I'll call a press conference and put a stop to it.
Oh! So,
yeah. Getting
to know you.
You're
married, gents.
So we're gonna look at campaign curveballs.
That'll be a lot of fun.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to having
Jane a lot.
Yeah.
Boy, did we have fun with Jane in Los Angeles.
Sure.
Can we tell you?
Yeah.
She's a party girl from way back, I'm telling you.
Get down.
All right, pick your news.
Okay. All right, what are the topics?
MTV update.
Yeah.
JFK Jr. gets jokey.
Okay.
Or famous bomb key in Heavenly Hill.
All right. Can we hit the music? Thanks. All right, JFK Jr. gets jokey, Fomke, what was the third one?
It's famous Fomke and Heavenly Hills together.
Okay.
Or MTV Update.
All right. JFK Jr. gets
jokey. No!
Oh, no, I'm sorry, that was Philip Macedonia.
No.
Give him what he wants. Give him what he wants. JFK Jr. gets jokey. Of course, his new magazine, George, is coming out September 26th. Mm-hmm. He threw a big press conference about it. Says he wants the magazine to be political and correct, but not politically correct. And this was his joke based on that sentiment. He says, we're not really politically correct. We do have one staffer that smokes and someone who has a crush on Pat Buchanan. I got to talk to that guy.
That's not bad.
I think it was in. I think I delivered it.
Yeah,
better.
I think so.
Because I heard it and it was like, whoa, that really wasn't funny at all.
No,
so
you did write
yourself well with it.
I heard him also say that his uncle, Ted Kennedy, Senator Ted Kennedy, said that if they were still speaking by Thanksgiving, he wasn't doing his job with the magazine. Because there's a lot of, you know, clearly people think it's going to be a liberal democratic platform magazine. So.
Sure. Can I just do famous Fomke and
yes,
sure.
Yeah,
only because, remember Fomke Janssen? Fomke Janssen?
Yeah. Fomke Janssen, she fed me French toast. Of course I remember Fomke.
She came on her, so she gets USA Today's Best Bet for Stardom.
Oh, good.
And then if you flip over to the top, Faith Hill's new album is the best bet to buy this weekend.
Yeah.
So I thought, both have been on Breakfast Time,
that's
so obviously
right.
We have everything to do with their success.
Yeah. And we were in USA Today yesterday.
Yesterday. Hope you picked up your copy of that.
That's right. We're all sending them cash. Since we saw you last time before Aloha Friday on regular old Thursday, each worm, now this is true, this is an actual statistic. Each worm at the Worm Connection ate its own weight in waste.
Ew.
Numb. Let's hear it for those worms.
Someone's got to do it, I guess.
Now, that apparently, that is going to be very important in the state of California as they are running out of landfill space. And here to explain and here to watch the worm have breakfast is Phil Kogan. Phil?
Jamelson eats his own height.
Yes, Tom. Good morning to you. Good morning to all of you. Good morning to you, Bobby Boy. Lovely to be a Friday, isn't it?
Uh-huh.
Let me tell you a little bit about these worms and this material that you see behind me. This green waste makes up 35% of the waste that we throw away. And as you said, Tom, we're running out of landfill space. So one way around that problem is to use these beautiful little worms right here who can eat their own weight, as you said, to reduce that amount of waste. In fact, they have to reduce their waste by 25%, and these worms, I assure you, we'll be able to do it. We'll show you why and how.
Okay.
We come back with our little wormy wormies.
Is that a farm worm or one you brought from home, Phil?
Jillian Hamilton wraps up a week in Texas. She's in Austin helping to celebrate, the preparations, because it's on the 15th of September, Mexican Independence Day. They're getting set for a big party there. Jill?
That's right, Tom. Next week kicks off a whole week of celebrations for Mexican Independence Day. This year marks the third year of official celebrations. When we come back, we're going to be meeting this mariachi band. We're going to be seeing the ballet folklorico and all other traditions and customs that prevail in Mexican American culture. We're going to learn that and a whole lot more when we come back in the first hour.
That's wonderful. That's great. Yeah, Bob.
It takes a big man to play Guitarro Grande.
See. I love that, dude. That's great. Hi, Jack. Jack's here, too, because we're going to talk with Steve Walker and also see, you ready, Bob?
Yeah.
Pets in high fashion, never needing a leash.
They never eat dog food. They only eat quiche. And I love them. Yes, I love them. Oh, how I love them.
The two of us work so hard on that.
Aren't they worth it?
We're going to celebrate the Mexican Independence Day. Also have Aloha Friday celebrations out in Madison Square Park with some of our Runway Rangers who are out there already. And we have scheduled to be here two Hawaiian chefs who are AWOL. And I asked about that. Apparently, Dano booked them. So that explains that.
I love women in dead grass. Yeah.
So that's all coming up.
So you guys made morning. Up that little ditty together.
Yes, yeah. We're so proud.
All morning.
Yeah. No. That's what happens when you go to the bathroom together. I know. They head into the men's room together and they come out with
all.
A little tune.
It's a guy thing.
It is a guy thing.
You
believe
understand.
That. Coming up right after the news, Karen Bryant, our music expert, is going to tell us what 5 CDs you absolutely must have in your repertoire to make it through college this year.
Okay. Did you watch the MTV
Tall
Music
Order.
Awards last night?
Yes, I did. I watched them.
It was not all that riveting.
Did Michael Jackson lip sync?
He didn't have a microphone.
Well, that's a bit fun.
Gee, maybe he can get one in Oz when he gets his brain, too.
All that coming up, but right now, let's take a look at some of today's top stories.
Good morning. I'm Jane Fergus. Here's what's happening in the news. Senator Bob Packwood resigned from office yesterday, just hours after the Ethics Committee released a 10-volume indictment of Packwood's personal and official misconduct. In a departing speech on the Senate floor, Packwood said, quote, "It is my duty to resign," and he added, "It is the honorable thing to do." O.J. Simpson's defense team ended months of speculation when they announced yesterday that Simpson will not testify. Simpson's attorneys said they didn't think his testimony was necessary because they claim the state's case is in shambles. They could wrap up their case in a day or two. The mega merger talks between Time Warner and media mogul Ted Turner's company are still going on. John Malone, head of the cable giant TCI and 21% owner of Turner's firm, will play a crucial role in the negotiations. They're expected to last through the weekend. In some tennis action, Pete Sampras and Jim Courier both advanced to the semifinals at the U.S. Open. The finals will be played this weekend. And finally, Hollywood film directors Woody Allen and Martin Scorsese will receive Lifetime Achievement Awards tomorrow at the Venice Film Festival. It's a quick look at what's happening in the news. Now here's Jim with the weather.
And we have courtly weather in Hampton, Iowa. Spiky yellow ball and the advent of fall. But the weather apples up as rain falls in Newton Falls, Ohio. We have this big area of rain here. We have a big area of rain here. And we have a lot of rain in southern Texas here. We got rain along the Great Divide here. Up there, there's rain in a lot of countries. Actually, weather's getting a little more interesting. Let's look at these high temperatures.
Fascinating.
Oh, and look how the 70s thing makes a big smile across the country. Of course, there's like a little bit of 90s drool there, but that's the weather.
You know, I'm trying to listen to Jane do the news, and all of a sudden, this incredible banging. This guy's over here. This guy, George, what's your last name, George? Come over this way so we can see it. What's your whole name?
Angelopoulos.
Well, good to have you here. What the hell are you doing, George?
I'm putting a locking cover on the thermostat.
Why?
Because everybody's tampering with it, and I've been getting calls 2 in the morning, 3 in the morning.
Tampering.
No AC.
Oh, so you're protecting the cold air. See, I like it cold in here.
Yeah.
So you're the guy that's going to make sure it stays cold. George, I love you. George.
Wow, what a moment.
How about a hand for George?
Yeah.
George. George. What? I know.
I hate the cold.
I know. My feeling is, Lori, if I can see my breath, I know I'm alive.
Man. You should see Tom's and my offices are right next to each other, and Tom's, you can hang meat in his office. And mine is like a luau. It's nice and warm and friendly and all that.
Nice stuff.
Now, if you're just settling in, into your college, thank you. If you're just settling into your college dorm, you know that music is an absolutely essential part of survival when you're spending a year at school. That's why we've asked Karen Bryant to give us her five picks of what you absolutely should have in your music collection.
Yeah,
this
now this was very, very hard for me. I own about 3,000 CDs myself, so this was very difficult.
So how did you base it? I mean, that's tough.
Well, I based it on things that had a mass appeal and that basically covered sort of a couple of genres, you know, some work of both. So if you, let's say you have a roommate, you know, and you guys don't necessarily like the same music, some of the things that might be able to find common ground.
All right. So what do we have?
Well, we started off with Nirvana, with the album Nevermind, because this is basically a Generation X classic.
Oh, yeah, sure.
You know, since Kurt Cobain's death, now you've got these amazing songs. I mean, all the songs on here are great, very rockin', but they've got choruses that you can sing along to. You can bond going, oh, man, he's dead, man, he's dead. And you got, you know, yeah, you can bond. So we actually, I believe, have some footage of Nirvana, the song Lithium, but just a solid record. And basically, when you're playing this one in the dorm, you are definitely putting out the call to people that I rock and, you know, I have a conscience.
Oh, okay.
So
I rock and I have
a conscience. Cool. So
very important things to be able to fake in college.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. Yeah. All right, so now secondly, after Nirvana, you've got your alternative thing down. I was saying you kind of had to have the greatest hits of Parliament, okay? This is the thing, George Clinton is basically the man, if you can say that. I mean, he is the funkiest guy around.
Yeah.
He, you know, he created so many riffs that a lot of people are stealing now. So when you listen to Snoop Doggy Dogg,
especially in rap, I was
exactly
gonna say,
you listen to Snoop Doggy Dogg and Warren G and all these people, they are sampling this stuff, and that's where you get it. So basically, if you get the Parliament's greatest hits,
how old is that?
I actually picked that up not too long ago. I don't know where it's what it says, what year it came out on. This time, you see, usually when you buy a greatest hits package,
84.
I consider it sort of a cop-out. But in this one, they have so much stuff, and you don't really, again, this style over substance, good for college. I look like I know a lot about the history of music, but in fact, I just have one CD. You know what I mean? It's really, and everybody likes funk, and the Red Hot Chili Peppers took a lot from that. Everybody, you know, a lot of people nowadays are really drawing from there.
All right.
So that's a great one to have. Now, thirdly, this is really my favorite. This is Rastaman Vibration from Bob Marley.
Cool.
Now, basically with Bob Marley, you can't go wrong, okay? But, you know, there is a greatest hits package. There's one called Legend. The thing about that one is everybody else has it. So, Lori, by taking this one to college,
you're a little different.
You look so much cooler because you're like, the greatest hits package, pshaw, I've got the real thing.
And I got George Clinton's greatest hits.
Exactly. Right? And with Bob Marley, I mean, you know, nobody doesn't like reggae. And if you could only buy one CD, I would say buy that one.
Okay.
Now, we also have Madonna.
But this surprises me that you would even pick anything by Madonna. Sure.
I like Madonna. I like her a lot. Absolutely.
She speaks very highly of music.
Doesn't she, though? Really? We've had fabulous lunches together. Like a Prayer, because the thing is, on this one, it's the... For the girls, it's, okay, it's Friday, we didn't get a date, who cares, let's sing around the apartment and dance. I know we've got footage of Madonna, too. And for the guys, this is the scenario. The cute girl from down the hall, she comes by, she sees this record in your collection, she says, oh my goodness, you like Madonna? Most guys are threatened by Madonna.
Cool.
I can't believe you like pop music. You're so secure, let's
psychological
date.
Warfare.
There you go.
Okay, and now, what I noticed here, when doing the rap from Terry and you picked four pretty old albums.
Right.
I mean, there's
absolutely
nothing from like 93, 94, 95. So, do you have anything new then?
Well, no. Some of these are for the rock and roll thing. You know, you can get your Hendrix, Are You Experienced, AC/DC, Back in Black, Led Zeppelin, House of the Holy, or you know,
Pink Floyd,
Killer.
Dark Side of the Moon.
Yeah, man, 40.
Dude.
But for good for blowing off class, if you want to. But for nowadays, I mean, it's hard. Like, the Red Hot Chili Peppers, they have a new record coming out in like a week and a half. I'm sure that's all you're going to hear this fall.
Sure. Yeah.
You know, at school. It's harder. Maybe it's just easier to pick older records because you have a perspective and you understand how important they are to your collection.
So these are the classics.
Right, that's sure. So a few years from now, maybe we'll have some new ones.
These are the ones you should be having
absolutely
in your college dorm room.
Get them those oldies.
Yeah.
Or just be yesterday's news.
Yeah. Nice stuff. I'd add a Kris Kristofferson CD only because he's here with us a little later.
I meant to add him
on the show, but you know, Karen made a good point. Everybody loves reggae, particularly the spin Bob gave it during the strut. So let's go out with a little of that while Jim tells us what else is coming. More reggae.
That's right. And we're going to watch some Mexican mariachis and jarabe dancers perform with their amazing feats. And Bob Kishin, who will, I believe, decline to dance.
on Breakfast.
It's 2 minutes past the hour. Welcome back to Breakfast. I'm Laurie. Tom, Bob the Puppet, and me, Jim. I'm the announcer, and here's Laurie, Bob, and Tom.
And the Rice, family. Joining us from Center Ridge, New York. It is Aloha Friday. Every Friday in Hawaii, we're celebrating that. But, Laurie, we need to ask you to do something special today, because it's also Kathy Rice's birthday.
Oh, I thought you were going to make a joke again.
No. Laurie has, it's safe to say, a unique and charming way of wishing someone happy birthday.
Now, Kathy, are you a regular viewer? So you know what's in store, do you?
Somebody better hold the baby.
Somebody protect the child.
The baby. And everybody help me with the happy birthdays, okay? All right. 1, 2, 3.
Happy birthday to you.
Kathy!
Happy birthday to you.
Kathy!
Happy birthday, dear.
Kathy!
Happy birthday to you.
Kathy!
Yeah!
Where's our presents? Oh, wait, that's not the way
it works. It's almost like a Tourette sing-along, isn't it?
Well, I do bring my own special spin to it, don't I? Sam, if people would like to join us for breakfast.
Oh, well, we got to introduce everybody.
Oh, I'm sorry.
We've got baby Dennis, who's only a year old and gets cranky if he doesn't watch Breakfast Time.
Oh, he's a
very happy
baby.
Baby Dennis?
Baby Dennis. Baby
Dennis. I heard him later on.
Yeah. Like little Stevie Wonder.
And this is John. He's a building engineer for Fortunoff.
Fortunoff, yeah.
All right.
Oh,
we welcome you both to Breakfast Time. And thank you so much for watching daily, especially, I think Kathy's the one that does the main plugger on it.
We need to give little Dennis a lay, so he's part of Aloha Friday.
He had one earlier. Was he strangling himself with
it? Oh, is that right? You don't want him to? Oh, that little choking thing. Good point.
I'm not even the parent here.
Bringing all my dad skills to the show. How about hot dogs? Does he want hot dogs?
Jim, if people do want to join us for breakfast, how do they go about doing that?
They should write to us at Breakfast Time, P.O. Box 825, Madison Square Station, New York, New York, 10159-0825. Or call us at 1-800-FXFXFX1. Or fax us at 212-802-4208. Or email us at fxbreakfast@delphi.com. Let us know when you're going to be in the New York area, and who knows, you might be invited in for breakfast.
You might even get welcomed in on Aloha Friday. John Cryer.
Hey!
Hey!
Hello, I'm good. How are you? Hi. Just thought I'd stop by. Was wandering by.
Where's Bob?
Sorry.
Yo, John, how you doing, babe?
What's up, Bob?
What's up, dude?
He looks just like I looked in junior high school.
Is that right?
Yeah.
So there's hope for Bob, you mean?
Striking resemblance. Grow one of these. You know, nobody's wearing them now.
You ready for a mariachi band?
I saw Jillian. She was unable to shake that mariachi band. She was like running away, and they're like,
"We're doing a whole show on musical stalkers."
You want to have a seat with me? We're going to actually join Jillian right now. She's in Austin, Texas. On September 15th, the Mexican people will celebrate their independence from Spain.
Actually,
that they got in 1810.
That's right, Lori.
Hi, Jill.
Mexican Independence Day. Good morning, Lori. It will begin with a group of celebrations kicking off September 15th here in Austin, Texas. We're with Gus, who is the mayor pro tem of Austin, Texas. Tell us, first of all, what is Mexican Independence Day?
It's the 185th anniversary of the Declaration of Independence of Mexico from Spain.
Okay, the culture says to celebrate with fiestas, dances, and music. Beginning with the music, this is a mariachi band. What characterizes a mariachi band?
This is the typical Mexican music group. The mariachi originated in the early 19th century, and they've been playing in this format.
Tell us about some of the instruments that we see. We have two violins and what else?
There's basically the string instruments, and then there's some wind instruments, but the mariachi basically is a string instrument group. They added the trumpet in the 20th century to give it more volume.
Okay, thank you so much, Gus. Now, here we are with Jesus, who is the director of the Ballet Folklorico. Tell us, what kind of dance are we seeing here?
We're looking at the Mexican traditional hat dance, and actually the name is Jarabe Tapatio. That is something that represents Mexico all around the world.
Tell us about the costumes. They're absolutely beautiful
and so colorful.
The costume represents the culture of Mexico. It's been, we adapted from the Spain. They represent the ranchero woman, the lady that works in the fields, okay? And the charro, that's the guy, the right horses, and they represent Mexico in Jalisco Casting.
Oh, thank you so much. That was wonderful. Now, Tom and Lori, I want you to stretch and warm up because in just a couple seconds, you're going to be learning some traditional Mexican moves. Our second group right here. This looks a little bit like the polka.
It's the polka, exactly. That's the influence from Europe. You can see the dress is a little bit has influence. It came from after the revolution. We adapted to represent this specific region.
Tell us about these costumes. She's wearing a beautiful aqua blue and purple gown. Tell us what that represents.
That represents, it doesn't have any meaning specifically. Each ballet folklorico choose the colors that you want to do it.
Okay, Jesus, just in the interest of time, I want Tom and Lori back at home to learn a step. Tell us a little bit about a basic step that we can do in a Mexican ballet.
Okay, the polka step that we can learn, we do heel, point, one, and two.
Okay, you got that, Tom and Lori?
We're trying.
All right, it's a heel.
Point, one, and slide.
Wonderful. We're going to thank you so much, Jesus. That was a lot of fun. We're going to end up now with the Council General, who was so kind. He greatly supports all of these fiestas and celebrations. Tell us, Roberto, tell us what are some of these celebrations and observances going to be this upcoming week in Austin, Texas?
The main event takes place on Friday, starting at 6 o'clock p.m., and it consists in charros, as you have seen here, mariachis, the ballet folklorico, other artists from Mexico, and especially a group from Nuevo León called the Linares Group. And after that, the ceremony of the grito.
Okay, thank you so much for supporting us and being with us this morning. When we come back, it's more fiestas and celebrations.
Sounds good. We've got a fiesta, we've got a celebration of Aloha Friday, and we have the Cisco Mitt over here. That's incredible.
Cisco.
Yeah. And we also have Captain Kangaroo Bob Keeshan with a calming thought for the day.
You know, sometimes you wake up in the morning and you're worried, well, should I try this or should I try that? And you're kind of timid maybe about it. But Peter Drucker had some words for you. Wherever you see a successful business, someone once made a courageous decision.
All right.
Jim, that was a fine effort.
It was a nice effort to give him a lay during Aloha Friday, but I think we may have been distracted from his actual words of wisdom, so if we could re-rack that and run
it
again.
That's a good idea.
And you just keep your paintbrush in your pocket, mister.
It's hard to do.
Let's hear the good captain one more time.
You know, sometimes you wake up in the morning and you're worried, well, should I try this or should I try that? You're kind of timid maybe about it. But Peter Drucker had some words for you. Wherever you see a successful business, someone once made a courageous decision.
Oh, I guess then that whole thing with the paintbrush was really a forward-thinking move on your part.
That's beautiful.
That's my surprise.
Jim, we got John Cryer in the apartment, and what else is coming up?
Picture Bowser in boxers or a chemise for your Pekingese. A fashion show for dogs hosted by Steve Walker. Highlights on Breakfast Time. It's 27 minutes to the top of the hour. Welcome back to Breakfast Time with Tom, Lori, Bob, the Puppet, and me, Jim. I'm the announcer.
Yay.
And here's Tom and Steve Walker and John Cryer and Bob.
Yay.
And Patricia.
Yay.
Patricia. By the way, it's Aloha Friday, celebrated every Friday in Hawaii. We're celebrating here in addition to the Friday strut and the mariachi band getting ready for Mexican Independence Day. And you're free to sing a cappella at home while you watch. Whatever you want to sing. Now, last night, you were working late last night, right? Hosting a charity event.
Yeah, I have big bags under my eyes. It's because I was at this big thing, big hoo-ha event.
Right.
It all benefited this thing called Powers, which is a nonprofit organization which provides services and food to people living with HIV and AIDS who want to keep their pets. And they help walk the dogs, they provide food, all kinds of things. About $20,000 was raised last night. How did they do it? They had big names.
How did they do it?
Good question.
That's your question.
Thank you.
They did it by having big name designers like Todd Oldham, Anna Sui, Calvin Klein design outfits for dogs. And did you see them? They're holding up cans there. I have to say, before we move any further, that this morning segment is sponsored by Sheba. And now I get to say,
by the way,
as if that isn't enough, I get to say, Sheba
Sheba.
To say I love you every day.
Really? Could you have a raw fish and say that to a cat?
Yeah. Right.
Now, I understand the only controversy last night was when Calvin Klein dressed puppies.
Yeah.
And that was, is that true?
That's so not true. So would you like to see about four or five of the big fashions that were on display?
I would indeed.
All right, we're going to start off with my dog, Jack.
All right,
who I said
Jack.
I'd never dress up, but I've gone ahead and put him in this, the designer's George.
Hello.
And you can see that it's got this thing that says, good dog, good dog, good dog, good dog, good dog.
It's a god dog.
It doesn't say good dog.
Good dog.
It says god dog.
Dogo, dogo, dogo dog.
Go dog.
Go dog.
Oh, there we go.
He looks like a superhero.
He does.
That's crypto. The dogo dog jacket against
he looks
George.
Really
the
oh,
next
really.
One yeah. Get this. Now this little dog named Charlie is a little shih tzu.
Go
Scott, go
him
ahead
up.
And pick him up so we can see that collar. Ready? It's a black velvet dog coat with jeweled flounce collar and Austrian crystal and bugle bead
collar. Oh, of course.
And this is Scott Stark who organized
what kind of dog is he?
Nice.
That's a shih tzu.
Bring him over to the visiting viewers, see if he hits the fan.
But coming up next.
Wait a second, did he hire new writers?
I'm just moving right along. We're just plowing right along. This is a great one. This is a reversible outfit modeled by our little pit bull, Ellie. This is a multicolored basket weave on one side, designed
really?
By Ellie.
She's
by
perfect
Dunnington.
For any occasion.
And
it
is perfect. Pit bull. Very colorful. Yeah.
Goes with anything.
And then on the other side, you can, I don't know if you can see, it's like black and white and kind of cool on the other side.
Now,
too.
In dressing a pit bull in this, are you trying to provoke him?
She likes it.
Oh, okay.
And she's, by the way, let's not get down on pit bulls. She's actually one of the best dogs that we've ever had on the show.
That's right.
Really good.
Okay.
Okay. Up next, evening wear.
This
animal,
evening wear,
is Gerard, a Briard. He's wearing a leopard tuxedo, believe it or not, designed by Townhouse. That was one of the big hits last night. And finally, Jack comes back with
a nice...
Uh-oh,
trouble. We'll see how good the pit bull is now.
This is a camel hair coat with faux, that's fake fur collar.
I am Robin of Locksley.
Bill Blast designed that, and my dog's dressing better than I ever dressed.
Okay, Jack, wet your lips. Pouty, pouty.
In camel hair.
Sell it.
All of these items went last night for a good cause, as I said.
Yes, indeed.
Uh-oh. Uh-oh. Here they go. There they go.
Let them play.
Wrong dog to tangle with, Jack.
Okay.
How about
they're playing a little too much at this point.
See, Tom, because they can.
Oh, they're playing.
Yeah. Okay. All right.
To say I love you.
Yes.
And how about a hand for
say I love you every day.
Sticking to the script while we were
playing.
Charming.
A valiant effort, Steve Walker, I must say.
Yeah.
Right now, let's check in with Jaina and see what's happening across the country.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Jane Fergus. Here's what's happening in the news. In the O.J. Simpson trial, defense attorneys are off to appeals court today. They're seeking to reverse Judge Ito's decision to tell the jury that Mark Furman was unavailable to return to the witness stand rather than explaining that Furman took the Fifth Amendment. Senator Bob Packwood resigned from office just hours after the Ethics Committee released volumes of evidence of his sexual and official misconduct. But Senator Bob Dole says Packwood will stay on for up to 2 months to tie up loose ends. At the U.S. Open today, tennis big shots will face each other in semifinal competition. Number 2 seed Pete Sampras will play Jim Courier, and Andre Agassi meets Boris Becker. The winners of those matches advance to this weekend's finals. At the MTV Music Video Awards last night, Janet and Michael Jackson won the Best Dance Prize for their latest video, Scream. And finally, Nancy Reagan was offered a starring role in a movie. Actor-director Albert Brooks says he met with the former First Lady this week to offer her the title role in his upcoming film called Mother. Nancy just said, no. That's a quick look at the news. Now here's Jim with the weather.
God bless Americus. Americus, Georgia, that is. Clearing skies there, but the weather's the pits in Pittsburgh. And we've got showers and thunder showers in this area. We also have showers in the Atlantic coast right down in through Florida. And then a big area of showers along the Continental Divide into the Great Northwest and that New Mexico-Arizona border that seems to be really wet. Let's look at those high temperatures. And as you can see, actually, it's not just the 70s that are smiling, but the 80s are smiling, even though it looks like they have bad teeth. And that's the weather.
John Cryer, star of Fox News series Partners, is here in the kitchen. John, do you want anything to eat?
A nice omelet, something
we can
with
do
some
that.
Cheese.
Adam, do you mind cooking up something for John?
No, I'm kidding.
No.
Really?
We'll feed you. We'll
if
feed
you want it, it's there.
Yeah. I'd also like somebody to peel me a grape. And sort of tropical drink.
Carrie Doyle from Harper's Bazaar magazine. We understand she's deciding whether to do a story or not on us, so we're offering her cash.
Okay. good
so
idea.
If you could peel grapes for her, that would be nice.
Donnie, that'd be good.
Little mailbag music, please, Maestro.
Katie Arthur of Waynesville, Missouri, a fax to us. Dear Tom and Lori, I will miss watching Breakfast Time. It comes on at 9 o'clock, and I have to catch the school bus before it starts. I mean, our schedule change in most of the country has upset many regular Breakfast Time viewers and pleased others who hadn't been able to see the show. Do you think you could ask our school to start later so I could still watch the best show on TV? Note from the mom, I'll record it for them until I can get the school to change their start time.
Well, do we know what school she goes
to? That's a darn good question. Katie and Bob are 9 and 8 years old. Can we get the school on the phone? She's clearly back in school. If we can call Katie's mom first.
Call the school.
Yeah, find out which school it is from Katie's mom, and then we can call the school and
get
the school on the phone.
There's very slim pickings as far as information goes there, so put your most dogged person on it. We've got to...
Jack?
Dogged. Darlene Shema of Highland, Indiana writes us, I'd be thankful if you could answer a very important question. Do you have viewer insurance? I ask this because last Friday my husband was running late for work, and I got him to do the Friday strut with me. I had forgotten three important things, our Chihuahua, Cocker Spaniel, and Great Dane. Every time Frank and I dance or play around, the dogs attack Frank. I train them that way. Our Dane gave Frank a nasty scratch on his side while doing the strut, and she wants to know if we can pay for the medical bills that ensued.
They don't need a check. They need Sheena.
Those are the dogs, the Spaniel and the Chihuahua and the Great Dane.
They even send the money.
All right.
Can't help you there, but we will send you a gorgeous FX t-shirt and to anybody whose letter we read on the air. Jim?
Yeah. That's right. Write to us at Breakfast Time, P.O. Box 825, Madison Square Station, New York, New York, 101.59-0825. Or call us at 1-800-FX-FX-FX-1.
Yes, slow down.
FX is 212-802-4208. Or email us at fxbreakfast@delphi.com. If we read your letter on the air, we'll send you the t-shirt in the mail. I'm going to get this all right. I got all the words.
Timing down first from the
weight,
order. You know?
John Cryer, who up until now thought he was invited in just to get lays draped around his neck and food stuffed down his throat, actually gets interviewed we continue.
No. Oh, my God.
And here's the job. Eat your weight in garbage every day, and we show you the worms that took it on Breakfast Time. It's a quarter till the top of the hour. Welcome back to Breakfast Time with Lori. Tom, Bob, the puppet, and me, Jim, I'm the announcer. And here's Tom and Lori and Bob and John Cryer.
That's right.
Yay.
Right
here.
Right here.
Cool.
Jim,
thank you.
Before your word of the day, Mark Sonnenberg, who's here from the West Coast, he's the only guy wearing a lay in a suit in the apartment.
I love that man.
He's not the only guy.
I love that man.
He's sucking up to the lady from Harper's.
Good. I love that man.
Good move.
Slipper of 50 anyway. See if we can get a story in Harper's. Anyway, Mark just told us that our big Goomba, our head honcho, and Sweeney.
Yes.
And the whole gang on the west coast of FX are all watching the show. They're having a big FX breakfast in California.
And they
weren't invited?
That's right. Well, we're doing the show.
We're kind of the host.
Oh, what's more important?
Eat the bread if you want,
Shut
but anyway,
down,
we
dude.
Want to just say, hope you're having a great time in the commissary, because we know how good commissary food is.
Hope you're enjoying the show. We're glad. We never get to see those guys. It's terrific. Jim, now, do you have a word of the day?
Well, speaking of commissary food, you know, I was talking over today's word of the day with Vendela while we were having breakfast this morning, and we were discussing sleepwear as a fashion statement.
Hallucination is the word of the
day. No. I do digress, and even more, Maestro. Prevaricate.
I thought it was hallucinate.
No. Prevaricate is simply lying.
Yes.
It's flat out lying. But, you know, and what it comes from is a Latin word which means to wander. So So you're wandering from the truth, which is not what I did with the Vendola story. Oh, I just leapt across the chasm there. Yeah. But it's what's interesting, it came from the when the Romans called you a prevaricator, they were saying you had knocked knees.
Was he still talking to us?
That's the word of the day.
Jim, can I have a little moment with you, Jim?
Yes, sure.
Jim?
Yeah?
Get over Vendola! She's over you! She's forgotten you!
Did I show you she gave me her underwear?
Get over it.
Those were pantyhose.
Every day.
Later in the show, our own FX shrink, Sheena Hankins, going to take a look at what we need to know about someone so we can tell if they're prevaricating or not. That's coming up a little later. And now, while our gang on the West Coast enjoys commissary food, really come closer to the screen, because you're going to see worms eat their weight in waste. All right?
Oh, yum.
It's going to be a nutrition off between commissary food and the worms in Moore Park, California. Phil Kogan is at a place called the Worm Connection. And this is all for really sound environmental reasons that this is happening. Right, Phil?
That's right, Tom. And that's why I wanted to do the story, as a matter of fact. Tom, you see this stuff right here? All these shrub cuttings and grass clippings and so on. We throw out a lot of this stuff, Tom. In fact, 35% of all the waste that we throw out is this stuff right here. And unfortunately, it gets thrown in a landfill, and it really doesn't have a chance to break down. This is a huge resource, Tom. What they do here at the Worm Connection is they take this stuff, they shred it up, and so it looks like this. This is sort of like the second stage of it. And then after a while, they leave it outside, and after about 3 or 4 months, it starts to turn into this stuff right here, which you've probably seen before, sort of compost material.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, by the time it's finished, and you'll know this if you've seen compost material before, it sort of starts to steam, and that's because of all the bacteria and so on, and all the little organic breakdown that's going on. And this is a wonderful soil, and like I said, a wonderful resource. And someone who knows a lot about this material is Jay over here, who's also a worm specialist. And he takes this resource right here, and add in the worms. Have we got some worms you can show, Tom, there?
There's our worms. Good morning.
Were you saying good morning for the worms?
Yeah.
Now, these worms are wonderful in the sense that they work with the soil, and they can break down the soil and turn it into a very valuable fertilizer. Could you explain to Tom how that process works?
Well, what we do is we take green waste, like grass clippings. We, as you described, throw it into a compost process, so those piles. Once it becomes more of a finished compost, we spread it out over these beds where the worms are, and then we start to water them, and the worms come to the surface and they eat the material and turn it into what is this dark stuff, an organic fertilizer.
Okay, so Tom, that material which started off as the grass clippings and so on, and once it's been broken down, putting it out on the beds like this and adding the worms, they have to go through a process that it's a delicate process of watering first and then adding more compost material with more worms and building up layer upon layer. And unfortunately, Tom, a lot of the grass clippings and so on, they get put in the landfill. It sits there, and it's really a waste of a resource, Jay.
Yeah, exactly. That's what it is. You can see we have the initial stage of the bottom of the bed, and he's putting new organic material on top for the worms to eat.
That's a nice ripe smell I got right there as well. Wafting.
Smells like money.
Yeah, you ought to smell
now,
the part.
Now once,
smells like money to him, yeah.
Smells, I tell you what, it is money, Tom. It's worth a lot of money. Now this, what happens after the worms break it down, Tom, is they eat it, of course, and we all know what happens when you eat things, it comes out the other end. And that's very valuable, and that really does smell like money, because it ends up like this right here. Now, this is called castings, correct?
Yes, okay, worm castings.
Now, explain to Tom just how valuable this is.
Oh, this is probably one of your most prized organic fertilizers. It's completely passed through the worm, and it's very valuable. You can't even find this bagged in large quantities. It has to be in small quantities, blended into the compost we saw over there.
Okay, now, the city of California right now, Tom, is trying to use these worms to break down 35% of their green material in order to use this resource that they have. This is something that people can do in their own home as well, Jay.
Yeah, that's where it's real popular right now, backyard composting in a small container for the food waste.
All right, thanks very much. The Wormies working with the green material, Tom, to save the earth.
All right, thanks a lot, Phil. And I have this image of people at the FX commissary stirring their food at their plate right now. Did you see little Dennis Rice crawling the whole perimeter of the bar? There he is over there. He's getting up a good head of speed. He's...
Oh!
Dennis, crawl into the bedroom. Lori's in there with John Cryer. She needs a chaperone.
Yeah, right. Wow. Do you have one of those at home?
No, not. I'm going to buy one in a couple of weeks, actually. Get a nice model.
Me too. They'll find a cute one. John Cryer, let's give it a big round. Breakfast time. Star of the famous Teddy Z. Pretty in Pink. He was Ducky. He was also the myopic guy in Hot Shots, if you remember that one.
Oh, yeah.
And now you've got a new sitcom on Fox called Partners.
Partners, yeah.
Exciting stuff.
Yeah, it is exciting. It's the show was produced by two of the guys who used to work on Friends, and directed by the same guy who did
James
Friends.
James Burrows. Yeah. Not too bad.
Who is very cool. And
there's some statistic, like he has directed the pilot episode of 12 shows that are going to be seen this fall.
Yep. He's the big one. He's the big guy.
I know your character's name is Bob.
Is Bob. I know I have very big shoes to fill in that arena.
Or one shoe in this case.
One big stump to fill. Yeah.
But I'm going to do my best. I think there's room enough for the both of us on television.
Now tell everybody the premise, because I think it's a really interesting idea for a show.
I play a psychopathic clown. No. It's about two guys who've been friends all their lives, and one of them decides to get married. Not to the other one, but it's a whole different thing.
That's another show.
And what happens is it's how their lives change when one of them.
When a chick shows up.
Yeah, when a broad messes up the whole.
Now, do we have a clip? I don't remember. We do. Let's take a look at a clip of John Cryer in action.
Run that bad boy.
So we're thinking of the wedding being on the 27th of...
You picked the date?
Yeah.
Just went off and picked a date?
We did.
You went off and picked a date without consulting anyone?
Well, the bride-to-be was there. But I'm getting the feeling that that's not who you had in mind.
I just don't know who you are anymore.
Good. Does this happen to you?
Oh yeah. When one of my closest friends was the first friend of mine to get married, you know, and the first one to take the plunge, and I didn't believe it. I thought it was like a joke he was pulling on me. Even at the actual wedding, I was like, okay, this has gone far enough. Okay, guys, no, seriously, you're not actually getting married. But he did, and now he's a dad. He's got the paunch and everything,
man.
And he talks like this.
I got rid of mine.
Hey, good job, dude.
I did.
You look great.
7 and under 60 today. So.
But hey, the one good thing about being the guy that isn't getting married is apparently you date a different woman on every show.
Oh yeah.
That's rough.
Oh yeah, that's the one part that's really like my real life. in that nobody will date me twice. I'm with a wonderful woman who's in England right now. So I'm not with her at this moment. I'm with a wonderful woman right now
keep
on the bed, but
there,
I'm working on it, guys. Work with me. But Bob is going to be quite the guy about town,
yeah.
Quite studly.
Oh,
yeah.
Now, I have to say that you are the kind of guy who pops up every couple of years.
And then disappears to well-deserved obscurity.
I think you got ripped with the famous Teddy Z because, Bob,
good,
and you said it too,
show.
It was a great show.
Oh, well, thank you.
Yeah, it really
thank
was.
You.
It got robbed.
It didn't have a chance. I'm getting bitter now.
But you've been sort of underground for about a year and a half. You've been working on something.
Yeah, I made a movie. I wrote a movie, actually, that we shot last year. Called The Pompatus of Love, which is taken from that Steve Miller song, The Joker,
sure.
You know, because I speak of the Pompatus of Love.
I'm a smoker.
Don't sing.
Please.
I'll stop at the bad line.
But for years, people have been going, what is that? You know, so we did a bit of research, and if you see the movie, you'll find out.
Is it out?
No, it'll be out in January.
Well, we'll look for it, and please come back and when it is coming out and talk to us about
absolutely,
it.
Absolutely,
all right,
I
John Cryer.
Yay!
Coming this fall.
Great
on
actor.
We have on the phone with us 9-year-old Katie Arthur from Waynesville, Missouri. She's in school. We got her out of class. Katie, you there, hon?
That's great. Yeah.
You are. Are you in the principal's office or the office area of the school?
Yes.
Is the principal nearby?
I don't know.
Can you ask one of the executive assistants?
The assistant warden.
Yeah. Would you ask them if the principal's there?
Yeah.
Could you do that right now?
Yes.
Okay, you ask them and we'll wait for you for a second. See if we can get the principal to the phone.
Okay.
And I'll update you if you're just joining us. What Katie wanted to know is if they could start school a little later. so that they could watch breakfast time and then head off to school.
I think that's a reasonable
request.
Yeah,
that's fair.
Yeah.
Ed, come on in.
No, he's not.
He's not there?
No.
All right, well, I want you to know, now that we know what school you're at, we're going to do our best to convince the educational system in Waynesville, Missouri, to start school a little later just to accommodate your viewing needs. Okay, Katie? Uh-huh.
Okay.
All right. All right. Now, this may make life a little difficult for you for a short period of time until we bring them to our way of thinking. Do you understand?
Yeah.
But you're ready for that.
Uh-huh.
Okay, Katie. Thanks for coming out of class.
Wait.
What class did you come out of? You don't even remember?
Well, it's only the second day.
What class did we pull you out of, Katie?
Just regular class.
It's regular class.
They learn to be regular.
I think it's probably the point where they don't change classes. They stay in the same room for the whole day.
All right. Okay, well, you get on back to regular class, okay, Katie? Thanks a lot, hon. Yeah.
Bye, Katie.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
You know, almost inadvertently, I start to talk like Bill Cosby. talk to the children.
No, it's worse than that. You said bye-bye.
Oh, no. Great win. We'll be right back. We're going to have a Hawaiian luau out in Madison Square Park. It's Aloha Friday.
It's 1 minute past the hour. Welcome back to Breakfast Time with Tom Laurie, Bob the Puppet, and me, Jim. I'm the announcer, and here's Tom and Laurie.
John, don't hurry now. I know you have to leave, but you can take that with you.
Take it all with you.
Really?
Yeah, take it all. When
does partners? Well, he needs to do a tag team.
Oh yeah,
you can't
right.
Have,
really?
I'll hold this for you.
Okay.
Partners is on Fox starting.
Yes, Monday actually.
Monday
after the big explosive episode of Melrose Place.
Oh, okay.
Oh, good lead-in.
Yeah,
where's he going?
All right, now he has other things to do.
He just got here.
I know, but he's
got to
leave.
What we'd like you to do, because we have another visiting celebrity waiting in the wings. Uh-huh. Can we get sort of a high five, a crossing of the celebrities? And I'll take your coffee.
I get to take the breakfast.
All right. Let's set it up. A little music. All right. Just feel the music, John. Be okay. One with the music. The celebrity cross.
Goodbye, John Cryer. Hello.
Hi, Jen. Now that's an actor.
Chris, welcome.
Welcome to Breakfast.
Chris Robertson is here. You've the first celebrity cross you've ever done?
Ever.
That's good. I don't think
I was real good at it.
You did great. No, you did great. I got to give him his
you
coffee.
Give him
I'll be back.
Yes.
Okay, we're going to sit you down here. We'll get you a cup of coffee, and we'll be talking about your new CD. Right there is good. Unless you want to talk about lying.
Talk about lying?
Yeah. We're going to go talk, actually, to our FX shrink, Sheena Hankin, about how you can tell if someone's lying. You want to come down and do that?
Yeah.
Okay, come on with me then.
Yeah, we'll
and somebody bring coffee for Mr. Christopher. Yeah, we're going to actually, because you know when Mark Furman took the stand a couple of months ago, everyone was wondering whether he was telling the truth or not. And our FX shrink, Sheena Hankin, says that probably with body language you could have told whether he was telling the truth or not. And
you
that's
better warn him that I'm down here.
My wife can do it.
Your wife can?
Hi.
Hi, this is Sheena.
Nice to meet you. Come
Why don't you have a seat there? This is John Davis.
Yo, Chris,
Jack,
what's up?
And our visiting family. You can sit right there, sure.
Hi, Chris.
Yeah.
Sorry.
So, Sheena, you really can't tell just based on body language?
Oh, that's little Dennis Rice.
Dennis.
He's one of our visiting viewers today. He said, do you want me to keep a watch on Dennis while you guys join?
I wish you'd bring him over here.
Bring him over here.
Here you go.
Chris
is homesick. You're homesick for your little one?
Yeah, I got a little one-year-old boy.
Want to go to Uncle Chris?
Yeah.
Uncle Chris?
There you go.
There you go.
That's so good. What a good boy you are. Yeah.
Now he's not lying there.
That's genuine.
So how do you spot a lie, Sheena?
Well, let's be clear. It's very difficult. Even polygraphs can only tell 75% of the time if people are lying. But you've got to look for the emotional clues. Not the facial clues. And those lying eyes that the Eagles used to sing about. Do you remember that one? with your lying eyes.
Yeah, I know.
Only I would sing in front of this guy.
Yeah.
Boy, you're a great singer, Sheena.
You noticed. I'm discovered.
I smell album.
And it will smell.
Don't look at people's eyes. You can't tell. Don't look at their faces. In fact, if you don't look at people's faces, you can listen to their voices. And voices are the best clue of all, Laurie. Listen to the voice, yeah.
Does that mean that if you know someone better, if you really know someone well, then you'd be able to tell even more if they're lying?
Sure, because you can listen to the difference in their emotions, and there's two ways to listen. One is if they go, let me tell you about where I was, really.
Yeah.
The hesitations and, that's a good clue.
The reason I came in, you said don't look, no, seriously, you said don't look at the face.
Yeah.
Lois, my wife of now 13 and a half years, always when we were dating, I'd notice her looking at my mouth. And I said, why are you... She said,
it had spinach in it.
No, it wasn't that. She said that she really felt that that was where a person betrays themselves.
Well, Chris just said that you said my wife always knows when I'm lying.
Absolutely, and I don't know what it is. I can be talking on the phone.
She knows your voice.
Yeah.
And of course, you've got the rehearsed lie, haven't you? Well, I'm so glad you asked me. Well, actually, this friend called up with a terrible problem, and I had to go right over there. And when they sort of have this script... You know it's not true.
Yeah. So what do you do if you're being lied to?
Now, well, that's a great question. If you think you're being lied to, number one, 25% of the time we're wrong, maybe even more. So you don't know if you're being lied to. Yeah. But what you don't do is nag, you don't yell and scream, because that encourages lying. It encourages people to punish you by not telling you the truth. So you stay calm and you ask people, to be honest with you, if they will. They probably won't, but you can try.
That's a good deal. Sheena Hankin, how to spot a liar and what to do about
another good thing to do if you suspect a person, see if they've worked with a screenwriter. Are there any tapes lying around? Let's kick off our second hour. What do you say?
Yeah.
I don't know if you folks realize it, but we are in what will one day be considered the golden age of infomercials. That guy with the English accent, he's going to be the Uncle Milty of his category. In fact, if he starts wearing a dress when he pedals the next Dyson carving Julienne device, the French will idolize him. Welcome back to Breakfast Time with Laurie Hibbert, Tom Bergeron, and Bob the Puppet. My name's Jim, and I'm the announcer. This is Good Morning. Here's Tom and Laurie and Bob and Sheena and Chris Christopherson and
the Rice family from New York Center Reach, New York, visiting with us as well.
And Chris Christopherson has nabbed their baby Dennis. Take it as his own.
Yes.
Chris with us this hour. Also, we're going to talk via remote to Lori Loughlin. She's out in Los Angeles. She stars after first The Edge of Night and then Full House. Now she's in a new series with Tony Danza that debuts, I think, next week.
Yeah, Hudson Street.
Yeah, so we'll talk to her, too.
Also, Jane Wallace joins us from Under Scrutiny.
Cool.
Thank you. You said some political...
Yeah, campaign curveballs.
How
odd little quirky things are happening that could upend certain frontrunners' campaigns. So that's what we're going to talk about.
Big packed full hour.
Yeah.
They all lie.
Well, you have to admire that kind of consistency. Say hi to our people in California. Haven't we kissed up to them enough, Paul?
No.
All right.
We want to say hi to all the FX staffers in California watching the show this morning, and Sweeney, or Man Sweeney all the way down.
No, you know,
chow down. Don't worry about us.
Yeah. Don't you people have any work you should be doing? Let's go say hi to our road warriors around the country. Phil's hanging out with the folks at the Worm Connection in Moorpark, California. Phil?
Yes, Tom, and this hour we're going to be harvesting worms, because that's one of the things that they're doing right here. They get these lovely little worms who are the newest employees for the state of California. They are helping with waste management. When we come back, we're going to show you how they harvest the worms and also how you can set up your own little worm box at home. Good little project.
Yeah. All right, Phil, thanks a lot. Jillian's in Austin, Texas, wrapping up a fine week in Texas and in fine fashion, too, as we get to preview preparations for Mexican Independence Day. Jill?
Yes, it's kicking off with a week-long celebration beginning September 15th
musical
in Austin, Texas. It's going to be fun. by some dancing and some songs.
Serpentine.
She does a whole lot of things. We're even going to be seeing a Mexican rodeo.
They're gaining on you.
Coming up in the second hour, so stick around for mariachi and the Mexican rodeo when we come back in our second hour.
Joan Cryer said it. She can't shake that band.
No, she can't.
There's just no way.
Also, in just seconds, I'm going to run out across Fifth Avenue over to Madison Square Park. We have a big Hawaiian celebration for Aloha Friday. The one part of it that is missing, I think, our two Hawaiian chefs are still AWOL, right?
Yeah.
We had scheduled a chef from the Royal Hawaiian Hotel and from the Sheraton Moana Surf Rider, neither of whom showed up.
Do you want to know my theory?
What?
They're friends of Chef Neil Becker. the chef that left the show because we weren't being nice enough to him. I forget.
Well, here's what happened. We were doing International Breakfast Week. That was the intent several weeks ago. We only got as far as Tuesday, I think.
Yeah.
And the chef felt that we weren't showing his food the respect it was due. And so
every island's food was sliced fruit.
Right. That was it. He left. Gee, can you imagine that happening on this show, huh? So he left after Tuesday's show, so you may be right.
That's my theory. And
he's cooking for the bottle rockets.
Well, let's take a look right now at what is making headlines across the country.
Hi, here's what's happening in the news. Senator Bob Packwood resigned on the Senate floor yesterday, calling it the honorable thing to do for his country. The Oregon Republican's resignation came just hours after the Ethics Committee issued a disturbing report detailing his sexual and official misconduct charges. Meanwhile, the who's who of Republican Party leaders are gathering in Washington today at Pat Robertson's Christian Coalition Convention. The convention is launching a new drive to expand its ranks before the next presidential primary. The FBI is reportedly launching an investigation into Calvin Klein's latest ad campaign. The provocative commercials featured allegedly underage models, and some critics have labeled the ads kiddie porn. At the U.S. Open today, top women's player Steffi Graf faces Gabriella Sabatini in semifinal competition. Number 2 seed Monica Seles plays Conchita Martinez. And finally, at the MTV Music Video Awards last night, R.E.M. landed the Video Vanguard Award, and Bon Jovi thrilled onlookers with a live performance in Times Square. That's what's making news. We'll have the weather now with Jim.
And nobody's fighting about the weather in Battle Mountain, Nevada. Spiky yellow ball and moderating temperatures. But there's action in Jacksonville, North Carolina, as we have showers all around here. We have another big area of showers in the Midwest, and then a big, big area along the Continental Divide there, going right out to the west. Also in southern Texas, a little thunder shower action, all right? Let's look at those high temperatures. We have actually pretty moderate temperatures, except for still like them lingering 90s. By the way, that little 90s thing in the west there eats its weight in garbage every day. And that's the weather.
That's special, Jim. Thank you very much. Now, Tom's gone across the street to check on the progress of our luau. We're not going to have any food, but you can still have a party, can't you?
Oh, absolutely. Actually, California's doing it.
Is he across the street yet?
Yeah, I made it.
Oh, good.
I made it. I'm over here. Before we get into what festivities are left, let's talk to the people who were sort of expecting the chefs to show up, too. Now, you're the publicist connected with, is it with the Sheraton? Is that right? Barbara and Amy?
Not something we want to admit right now.
I bet we can get a good rate on rooms for the next few months.
Yeah, no kidding.
So, yeah. So, we have a Hurricane Louise just hit one tree. Are you all right?
I survived the hurricane.
We've got stalking mariachi bands and goosing palm trees on the show today. All right, so Barbara, Amy, what do you think's happening here?
Well, we think it was the Menahunes. We have these legendary little people like leprechauns in Hawaii, and I'm sure they came here and took them.
You buying that story, Amy?
They're lost in New York, that's all I can say. Okay. They're cruising around somewhere.
They're the Macaulay Culkin of chefs.
When they show up, we'll throw them in the volcano.
They're cooking for somebody right now, I'm sure. A wonderful meal.
If they're a Good Morning America, we get free rooms for a year. All right, let's meet some visiting viewers who came by, too. Now, where are you from?
I'm from Aptos, California.
Uh-huh.
Came all the way from California, born and raised in New York City. Haven't been here in 20 years.
What's your name?
Jana.
Jana and?
Bob Campbell from Montana.
And you're just here to visit with us?
Dude. Let's open, see some plays. It's a wonderful time of year to visit, and I'm so happy to be on the show, really.
Aww. Thank you. It's good to have you here, and they, we didn't press them. They actually came this way. Now, we've got some of our runway rangers here, and they're hubba, giving hubba. Us a little bit of the sense of the heck have you been eating? giving us a sense of the island. Barbara, Amy, come on over here.
He's doing that rave luau.
As best you can, give us a sense of what would have happened had your guests arrived with you.
Well, we have a lovely hula dancer, Madeline, who would have done some hula.
So the chefs took her, too?
She's with them as well, yes.
They're not crazy.
The whole lot of them.
Oh, that kind of explains everything, doesn't it?
She would have done a beautiful hula and shown everybody how to do a dance. And, you're going like...
There's
going to
be a call. There's going to be a call about 2 in the afternoon going, oh, man, I'm with these chefs. Wow. Well, how about a hand for our good-spirited runway rangers, for Barbara and Amy, for taking the heat from our visiting viewers, who, by the way, you're invited to come on up to the apartment, too, since you made the trip here. All right, it's the celebration of Aloha Friday that we will continue with, albeit using mariachi bands, later this hour. Lori?
Thank you very much. Coming up, Kris Kristofferson's going to talk to us about his new CD and maybe sing for us. Who knows? I haven't had to talk to him about that yet. But all that and lots more coming up, Jim. What else?
Rodeo de Mexicano. Rodeo with a salsa accent. Coming up on Breakfast Time. It's 19 minutes past the hour. Welcome back to Breakfast Time with Lori, Tom, Bob, the puppet, and me, Jim. I'm the announcer.
Yeah.
And here's Tom and Lori and Bob and Kris
Kristofferson.
Kris's new CD is called A Moment of Forever. We're just chatting. We're always intrigued with how people react when they first get in here to the apartment. I was telling Kris that our show operates under the theory that a moving target is harder to hit. How'd it feel?
It felt like a twilight zone. Nobody told me what I was coming into. It's it's a little unusual anyway, just to be dressed up as you walk in like this.
Yeah.
But so far, I haven't really figured out what's going on.
You know what? We've been doing the show. We're in our 16th month.
Mm-hmm.
You don't figure it out.
It's starting with that celebrity
John Cryer who came in and gave
that was a wake-up call for me.
Did anybody tell Kris about the mud bath segment?
Nah.
Actually, we're celebrating Aloha Friday, and since all of our Hawaiian guests didn't show up, we're going to weave our mariachi band. Yeah. Oh, good. Look us down in the booth.
I've carried down here. We're talking over. By the way, we're going over money here.
Carrie Doyle is from Harper's Bazaar magazine. She's deciding whether or not to do a story on FX and Breakfast Time. Carrie, what's our percentage going so far?
Well, I was just outside getting some money from everyone out there.
Oh, good.
Oh, good.
Wow. Yeah, let's see how it goes.
Wow, someone from Bazaar with someone who is Bazaar in the same booth.
That's right. Jillian's in Austin, Texas, and they are getting set for the September 15th celebration of Mexican Independence Day. Jill?
That's right, Tom, and not only will it be characterized by fiestas, dances, and song, but there'll also be the Mexican rodeo, or charas. We're here with Roberto, who is the head of the charros here in Austin, Texas. Good morning, Roberto.
Good morning. How are you this morning?
Okay, let's get the show started. Okay. It's a little bit, I call it a rodeo as an American, but what is it really?
It's called a charreada. In the charreada, this is the first event we do, is the Cala de Caballo.
Okay, let us begin.
Here we go.
And it starts with what? We have a rider coming in on a horse.
He'll be coming in at full speed. It's a reining event. And here he'll set his horse down, and then he'll do his turns to the left and to the right, and then he'll back up his horse.
How difficult is it for the rider to turn left and right and spin around like that?
So this particular horse has been in training for 2 years. As you can see, he does very well. But it takes a lot of time and patience for him.
Okay, let's see another event. We have also the rodeo.
We have Efrain working the riata, which is the rope. Está floreando, what we call a floreo. What this event is, he's just working his rope. He's showing that he masters the rope. He's in control at all times.
Would he use that to rope an animal or to capture an animal, or is it more a show of skill?
Yes, it's also a show of skill and it's an art, but also we use this. He has to know these because in the charrería it's a point system, and the more events he does with the rope, the more points he gets. He accumulates points as he's going through the event.
Okay, let's see our third event. Here we have what?
What we call is the manganas a caballo, where you got three drivers driving the mare, and he throws the rope, and he, as you can see, he only got one front foot this time, but we'll try again if we have time.
Okay, let's see. What he's actually trying to do, Tom and Lori, is the man with the rope is going to try and rope the leg of the mare There are three riders behind him getting that mare to go around. It worked last time. We're going to try it again. What other events do we have?
Okay. While they're preparing right quick now, since we don't have enough time to do that, we're going to do what we call the Paso de la Muerte, which is the most dangerous event.
Yes, Muerte. That scares me, Roberto. What exactly is this about?
It's called the Pass of Death. What it is the mare will come out of the chutes, and the rider will be riding bareback from his horse, and he'll mount the mare riding at full rate of speed.
Okay, so he's going to jump off his horse onto another mare. And what makes it really dangerous, Tom and Lori, is that there are three riders right behind him on horseback. And if he misses the jump, he'll get run over by the three horsemen behind him.
Let's
They're getting
miss.
Set up. Let's see him do it.
Out. The mare comes out now. As you can see, he's getting prepared mentally. He's going around. And the three riders are behind, so you can see if he falls, the three riders will trample him over. And now he gets ready. He prepares himself by throwing his left leg up.
He's going to go. He's going to jump over.
Yeah.
He made it.
Hey.
He made it. Yes.
All right.
Great. That was great. We do have another 45 seconds.
Yes.
Could you ask them to see if they could rope the mare for us?
There's not enough time because the mayor's in the chute right now.
End on a positive note.
This time
he's
out.
Producing the segment, Tom. Let's just let him go.
Back to the public. They'll be addressing themselves. We'll give them a good round of applause.
Yeah.
Let's not forget also that the mariachi before, they would be playing all throughout the celebration. We would hear them playing. Thanks so much to Roberto. And goodbye to our riders, and goodbye from Austin.
Nice job. Very nice. You know, who was it that thought that it wasn't tough enough to go to, on one horse? You had to have three people to trample you to death.
Yeah.
Who was that? Yeah.
Hey, Chris was saying, you've seen that before. You actually, Spanish was your first language, wasn't it?
Yeah. I grew up down in Brownsville, Texas, and spoke Spanish before I spoke English.
Oh, but, do you still use it?
Yeah, sometimes. Mm-hmm. Sometimes when I've been in Spain, I've used it. But I live in Hawaii right now, so I don't have.
You came on the perfect day then.
Yeah, it was.
Because it is Aloha Friday. Not only do we have Christmas stockings, we've got Jay Walsh.
Jay!
Come on in.
Yeah, play her theme. She won't come in if we don't play her theme.
Don't worry, guys.
Hello.
Right, I'm
Jane. Jane. Lucy right there.
Big one. All right.
Hi, Jane.
Oh, and
hi, Jane.
Chris. Hi. Jane Walsh. Jane hosts Under Scrutiny, our nightly news show.
Jane.
Hello, Bob. Good. Bob, aren't you going to give me my lay? I was told I'd get a lay if I come on this show.
There's a line here, but I'll leave it alone.
Okay, let's go to break.
Please, before I say something.
You can have mine.
He's coming to the new series, Hudson Street, this fall, Lori Loughlin, but she's coming to Breakfast Time today. It's 28 minutes past the hour. Welcome back to Breakfast Time with Tom, Lori, Bob, the puppet, and me, Jim. I'm the announcer, and here's Tom, and Chris Christopherson, and Bob, and Jane Wallace.
And Jane Wallace.
It's an all-star cast.
And a bunch of runway rangers wearing makeshift grass skirts. I mean, what more do you want?
Women in dead grass, my favorite.
This is like Timothy Leary meets Gilligan's Island, isn't it? It's amazing. And we go now to a sheriff's office, the West Hollywood Sheriff Station, where we welcome one of the stars of a new series on ABC, Hudson Street, where she stars with Tony Danza. Lori Loughlin is with us.
Yay!
Lori, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good. Now, why did they drag you into the sheriff's station, or are we catching you at an inopportune time?
I've been arrested. I was out walking the streets last night. Now, as you probably don't know, Hudson Street is set in cop in the station.
Right. And
you know what? I can hear this funny kind of echo.
Oh, no.
That's just our audio.
That's
so I have to listen. So I actually have to listen to myself?
Yeah. So that's a special.
That's awful.
A special feature of the show. We supply it as a.
Well, anyway, Hudson Street is set in the police station.
Yeah.
And that's why I'm here. I play an investigative reporter.
All right, we're going to see a clip of you from the show, so this way you get to hear yourself in triplicate.
Oh, no.
So let's go
How
to
awful.
A clip of Lori and Tony Danza from Hudson Street.
Thanks. You know, that is so rude.
Oh, I'm sorry. I was just that I was supposed to be at that game.
Oh, but instead you're stuck here with me?
Oh, no, I wouldn't say stuck.
Oh, no, come on, let's just be upfront about this.
As opposed to every other topic we've discussed.
Oh, so now you're saying I'm too forthright?
No, I would never say anything like that, not without my bulletproof vest.
You still need more time?
Nope, we'd just be wasting it.
All right, Lori, yeah.
Wow.
Now, can you still hear yourself, Lori?
Let me see. No, I can't.
Oh, good.
No, actually, no, I can. I can. It's terrible. But let me show you something. We're very official here at the West Hollywood Police Station.
Oh,
see that?
Nice.
Welcome to the West Hollywood Police Station.
That's
and this is my friend Steve over here.
Mm-hmm.
We've been discussing donuts. What do you think? Jelly or chocolate glazed? What's your favorite?
Sheriffs don't eat donuts.
Oh. We're in good shape here in California. Really good shape. Health food bars. There you go.
Yeah,
how about
really?
That OJ case? Okay, no comment.
You know,
whoa. We're having trouble here with the camera.
That's all right.
Please
go ahead. Duck and cover.
Got like an NYPD blue thing going on here, which we have very nice blue walls here at the West Hollywood Police Station.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Keep the prisoners calm. Really calm. Come this way. We'll see if we can find some prisoners for you. But we're not allowed to put them on camera. Now, you have like a Hawaiian thing going on
yes,
there?
Yes, we do.
With all your lays around your neck? Well, we don't have that, but what we have here, handcuffs.
Oh, good.
No one should be without them.
Hey, Lori, you haven't found a couple of drunken Hawaiian chefs there, have you?
Mike, they're right in there, in the holding cell. Hey, guys. There's a prisoner.
Yeah.
We can't show you him, though.
That's just what they want to see, an attractive woman waving at them and then leaving again.
Okay, now wait. We bring the prisoners in.
Get those fire hoses ready.
See these footprints here?
Yeah.
This is for line dancing. That's what we got going right here.
At the Copa.
It's a good thing
Copa
here.
Cabana.
We're always thinking down here in California. And look, we got a holding. Oh, it can't go in there. The nice holding cell, telephone, couple of phones here.
Very nice, for the final call.
Well, you're right there.
Lori, when does Hudson Street debut?
September 19th on ABC at 8:30.
All right, so you're going for another hit, and it looks good. You're between Roseanne and Home Improvement, right?
Yeah, good time slot.
That's
really good
very
time
nice.
Slot.
Thank you for the tour. That was great.
Yay.
All right, Lori Loughlin.
Bye, you guys.
Yeah. Good luck. Hudson Street, Tony Danza on ABC. That's nice. Yeah, very nicely done.
Lots of fun. Let's now check in with Jane Fergus, not to be confused with Jane Wallace, who's coming up later, and we'll see what's happening across the country.
That's right, but we'll both tell you what's happening in the news. The Justice Department confirms it's doing a preliminary investigation into Calvin Klein's recent ad campaign. The probe will determine if the ads showing scantily clad models are in fact child pornography. Calvin Klein Incorporated says it will issue a statement later on today about that federal investigation. Senator Bob Packwood is ending his 27-year Senate career in the wake of sexual and official misconduct allegations. A recent Ethics Committee report strongly recommended Packwood's expulsion from the Senate. By resigning, he keeps his Senate perks intact. He also retains health benefits and an annual retirement income of nearly $90,000. O.J. Simpson's dream team is putting out some mixed messages. Two of his defense lawyers say Simpson won't testify, but his lead lawyer, Johnny Cochran, says he's still keeping that option open. And finally, platinum-selling jazz musician Ronnie Laws is coming out with a new album called Natural Laws. Laws is a charter member of the band Earth, Wind, and Fire, and his new music explores the significant role of African-American cowboys in the American West. That's what's making news. Now here's Jim with the weather.
A spiky yellow ball and a hint of fall in Pawhuska, Oklahoma. And the rain will flow gently and not so gently on Avon, Colorado. Look at this big area of rain here. We got an area of rain in the Midwest there and an area of rain in the Southeast there. Also, rain showers in Hawaii. Tell Chris, showers in Hawaii. Let's look at those high temperatures. And those are the high temperatures. That's the weather.
Yeah, very much.
That's almost like the waiting room for interviews over there, isn't it? Jane and Chris over there.
Jane Wallace, Chris Christopherson.
Yay.
Still a whole lot of show coming up.
Sure
Jim.
Is.
What else?
And we're also going to talk about harvesting worms. It's not just one woman's dating history. It's a business. It's 23 minutes to the top of the hour. Welcome back to Breakfast Time with Lori, Tom, Bob, the puppet, and me, Jay. I am the announcer. And here's Lori and Bob and Jane Wallace and Chris Christopherson.
Yay! Special guest this morning. We're so happy to have him here.
Yay!
We have to be on really
up.
Careful because Dennis Rice, our visiting baby, fell asleep.
He just, he opened his eyes for just a second when we were all applauding. He knew it wasn't for him, and the eyes went down.
Yeah. Right back to sleep.
He's a show business baby.
We are among greatness today, ladies and gentlemen. We're sitting beside the man who has clocked over 1 million miles on a tour bus. You've won Grammys. You've won a Golden Globe. You've had a platinum-selling album. You've just had a terrific career. Your latest album, first time in about a decade that you've put all original songs together on one album. Well, why did it take so long?
It wasn't up to me.
Never mind that.
Rhodes Scholar and Golden Gloves boxer and a bunch of other stuff?
I beg your pardon?
I'm over here.
He's a puppet.
I'm over here.
Yeah.
You were a Golden Gloves boxer, weren't you, one time?
Long
and a Rhodes Scholar?
A long time ago.
Yeah. I have a long memory, Chris.
We just humor him. You just nod and say, yes, Bob. And
I inhaled.
Now, this album, A Moment of Forever, has some of the most beautiful love songs on it. I mean, I was listening to it this morning in my office. It's just, so what inspired, was it your baby that inspired you to write all these beautiful love songs?
I have a real happy life that might help. I got a lot of kids. My youngest one's about as old as Dennis over there. And I guess all the songs are just reflections of the way my brain works out what I go through.
There's one called
I don't know how I'm going to work out this morning.
Yeah, I know. If you write a song about this, we want to know about it. That's for sure. There's a song called Shipwrecked in the 80s. And I was wondering what was that all about. I was reading the lyrics over there.
Yeah, you don't have to tell her.
Now you can keep shipping. Yeah.
It was, it's a personal sort of statement of being adrift that fit not only me, but a lot of other people's of maybe my generation and after, who were looking at a different world than we grew up in when God was on our side.
Does that generation feel more comfortable in the 90s?
I think we're still adrift in the 90s.
Still adrift. Yeah. Jane Wallace is having a fit over here. Yeah. Anything you'd like to ask him, Jane?
No, I'm enjoying just listening.
And you've agreed to play a song for us. We couldn't be happier. What are you going to sing?
Well, do you want that one, or do you want
Shipwrecked in the 80s would be great.
Well, I'd be playing a harmonica if I had it. Well, you fight like the devil to just keep your head above water. Chain to whatever you got that you can't throw away. And you're shooting through space on this river of life that you're riding. And it's whirling and sucking you deeper on down every day. So you turn to your trusty old partner to share some old feeling. And you find to your shock that your faithful companion is gone. So long, Tonto. And the truth slowly dawns that you're lost and alone in deep water. And you don't even know how much longer there is to go on. And I usually sing this for the Vietnam vets, for Native Americans, or anybody who's paid a particularly high price for the privilege of being an American. Like an old holy Bible you clung to through so many seasons, with the rules of survival in words you could still understand. When they prove something wrong you believed in so long, you go crazy. And you're so close to folding the cards that you hold in your hand. Cheery little song.
Singing Holy Toledo, I can't see the light anymore. Hank Williams said that. All those horizons that I used to guide me are gone. You identify. And the darkness is driving me farther away from the shore. Throw me a rhyme or a reason to try to go on. Come on, Dennis, throw me a line, brother. Any kind of a line, huh? Thank you very much.
Yeah! 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 Yeah!
14 minutes is WDL. Welcome back to Breakfast Time. Here's Tom and Lori and Chris Christopherson. Yeah.
That's right. This is a CD, A Moment of Forever. Yeah! Unfortunately, our moment has ended. Chris, thank you. Thank you. Can we get a Runway Ranger escort for Chris? Yeah. A little luau escort. You know, with the hips and the thing, and they'll do the whole escort him out. Chris,
I might have fallen right out.
Oh, man.
Cool.
We throw a nice party, don't we?
We sure do. And that was darn nice of him to sing, because that wasn't in the original. But there's Jane.
Nope. Yay.
Well, we cast him. One of the things that we're real happy about in moving to 10 o'clock Eastern is that one of our cohorts here at FX has consented to stop by during breakfast time. Jane Wallace, let's hear the thing.
Wait, that's the Under Scrutiny Orchestra, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Yeah. And guess what? They're becoming the Under Scrutiny dancers now. The Runway Rangers. Still wearing the lipstick you planted. Let's talk about...
I noticed you're trying to preserve that a bit.
Yes, I am. Okay. Until about just before I go home. Let's talk about these campaign curves that are going on here. Now, Packwood is resigning. Big surprise.
Uh-huh.
But I understand.
Actually, it is a bit of a big
surprise. Do you think so?
I mean, he's dragged down for 33 months. This thing is 33 months old. That's nearly 3 years of salary, pension benefits.
But I know.
Not to mention the good graces and the franking privilege.
But it really got to the threshold where he realized if he didn't resign, if they kicked him out, he'd lose all those benefits.
Well, I think it was the health benefits.
Yeah, I think
that
so
was
too.
The deciding factor. But then did you see Bob Dole now? Wants to keep him in another 90 days to clean up his things.
Yeah.
I would say that would be normal.
Based on what I read in the diary excerpts, his office is a mess.
Yeah. I was going to steer right around what things he needed to clean up, but okay.
Yeah. The, no, that one down.
Don't you get me going.
Get her going.
90 days because he wants... Packwood is the head of the Senate Finance Committee,
right.
Because Packwood actually did sneak a little work in there between the extracurriculars, apparently.
In between gropes.
Yes, right. Well, gropes would be kind, even.
Yeah, really.
Did you read in those excerpts of those
diaries? Yes, I did. I was online last night reading some
How late did you stay up?
I kept feeding new excerpts, so I was waiting.
If you were the tiniest bit sexy,
it'd be
like a potboiler. It'd be a bestseller.
Now, my understanding is that Dole, who is, of course, the Republican frontrunner currently, check your watch, is concerned that Phil Graham might get in on the Finance Committee. Now, why would that mess with anything Dole's doing?
Well, because that could, let me put this the nice way,
all right.
That could stand in the way of tons of important Republican legislation that all has to funnel through finance in order to be passed, which would make Dole, A, not look like a great majority leader because he can't control his own Senate.
Right.
And B, screw up the contract with America Agenda the year going into the primaries when Dole obviously still has to run.
One quick question about the spouse factor for a couple of other possible contenders. Newt Gingrich's wife said if he announces the next day she calls a press conference and torpedoes the whole thing. Colin Powell's wife yesterday said that she's not too crazy about the thought that he might run.
Well, Colin Powell's wife I don't know well enough to judge whether that would have any effect, and that's a milder statement. Newt Gingrich's wife looks like she has the potential for major league public extortion. What she don't want, don't go. Because you saw her reaction to the Vanity Fair piece where it was noted that he was in Packwood-like activities about town throughout his career.
Yes.
And she, I can't remember the exact quote, but she lambasted him quite readily.
Yeah, I think Gail Sheehy's the least of his worries.
Yes. Well, I think it, in fact, might have boosted his stock.
Well.
Newt Gingrich, sex. That was the first association I had.
Now, in the interest of just, you know, shows sharing here, can Bob, Laurie, and I show up on Under Scrutiny some night and just...
Oh, I do wish you would.
Yeah.
I really do wish you would. I'm just trying to think up the best topic for you to come.
Oh, okay.
Perhaps the grass skirt people would be good.
Yes.
Maybe on a Bosnia night. What do you think?
Oh, maybe not. Jane's going to be... I've been saying she's a regular now on Breakfast Time.
Yes.
I keep saying
hey,
that to her.
Hey,
we'll get you back.
I agreed once.
Come
this
on.
Is worse than Packwood. I agreed once.
No,
yeah, but you said once four times.
Jane Walsh.
Hey.
On FX. You'll come back. You will.
Only if you bring my band.
Problem. Jim, what's coming up?
Worms, Squiggly, and Icky as individuals. Worth a fortune when you get them together in gangs. Coming up on Breakfast Time. 3 minutes to the top of the hour. Here's Laurie.
Thank you very much. Hey. Gwen McGee is standing by at the Motown Cafe, which has a grand opening last night right here in Manhattan. And what kind of stuff do they have down there, Gwen?
They have so many things, Laurie, you wouldn't believe it. We got us some sunshine here on a cloudy day. I'm standing by at the opening with the Temptations.
Oh,
here.
Yeah.
Right.
Yay.
This is Otis here. Otis, tell me, how does it feel to be an actual part of history?
Truly awesome.
And enough said. If you want to see more of the Temptations and the beautiful memorabilia they have inside, we're going inside and we're going to talk to the Temps when we come back right here on Personal FX. See you guys later.
So Gwen will be on Personal FX coming up right after Breakfast
She's
Time.
She's such
Check
a tease.
I know. Yeah. I thought we were going to get the Temptations too.
All right. Well, it's coming up on FX, so you get it all, certainly. And you'll find out about the second annual FX On the Road sweepstakes if you just keep looking at your screen. Mary Doyle of Harper's Bazaar getting her last bribe of the day from Jack the Dog.
Yeah.
We'll see your story there yet. To our FX gang watching on the West Coast, we're rerunning Thursday and Friday's show over the weekend, so we don't have to call you. Have fun. Thanks to Chris Christopherson, John Cryer, Lori Loughlin, our own Jane Wallace.
Jillian Hamilton in Austin, Texas. Good work this week. Also, Phil Kogan.
Yes.
Out in Moore Park, Los Angeles, California. Next week, Daisy Fuentes, Gary Marshall, Jill Sobule, Tempest Bledsoe, Dom DeLuise will be back in the apartment.
Oh, good. That's it. He's a threefer.
He's
back
threefer.
For the third time.
Great week. You have a great weekend. We'll see you Monday.
Claire and John are ready to go. Personal FX up next. Take care, folks.
No!
Good morning, I'm Jane Fergus. Here's what's happening. Assistant Secretary of State Richard Holbrooke says warring factions in Bosnia have agreed to set up a framework for peace. Colin Powell's wife says she does not want the retired general to run for president and says if he tries, she would fear for his safety.